Case studies is a term that you're going to hear a lot about during your product design career. Every designer has their own interpretation of what a case study should look like, and it's good to learn from a multiple range of sources when it comes to building your own case studies. With that said, I do personally have a format that I follow, and I'm going to share that with you today. If you're new here, hi, what's up? I'm Gemma, and I'm a senior product designer who share tips about UX for free. If that's something you're interested in, then why not hit that subscribe button, turn on notification bell to get notified every time I upload a new video. So I personally house all my case studies on my website, and my website is built in Webflow. I also password protect all of my case studies. So if you went to my website, you are able to find the tab that says case studies, but you will be met with a password protected page. But I am also able to share these case studies with future employees without the fear of somebody else finding the case studies. And the reason why I do that is because I've either signed an NDA in the past, or I just don't legally have the rights to showcase this work online, so I password protect everything just to keep myself covered. I would suggest you doing this as well, unless you have a written permission from the client that you worked with to say that you can showcase this online. Okay, cool. With that said, let's get into it. What is a case study? Now, a case study is something which is slightly different to a portfolio, and they kind of cross-reference each other, but a portfolio is normally a short snippet into something that you're showcasing. So if you're a marketing manager or if you're a photographer, portfolios are a very, very good way to get attention. But when it comes to case studies, it's all about how you did something, the process, how you solved a problem, which you can't necessarily get across when you just show an image of the final product. A case study will showcase the designer's skills in a written narrative with the use of text and images, the story of how you solved a problem. This will then help you showcase your skills and what you can offer going forward in your next role. So now that we know the differences, how do we approach a case study? Now today I am going to show you one of my case studies, but I am going to blur out all the images and I'm going to blur out some of the key text as well, but it will give you enough information in order for you to write your case studies going forward. I also have a written document that I'm going to share at the end of this video, so please be sure to check out that. And without further ado, let's get on with it. Now that we know the key differences between a portfolio and a case study, how would we approach a case study? Recruiters want candidates to communicate their design decisions as they skim through the content. Typically, we like to spend about 5 to 8 minutes on per case study. You should aim to communicate your design process as quickly and efficiently as possible, and make sure you're concentrating on the key points throughout the whole project. Your aim for this is to persuade recruiters by showcasing your skills through your processes and your choices, and then engage them with images as support. So let's take a look at a real case study that I have in my portfolio. So the first thing we need to take into consideration is the introduction. An introduction is a short sentence explaining what the project is all about. Then we would start to go into more detail about the role that you did, what type of company you worked for, and then a link to the website. And the reason why we do this is to highlight straight away what we did going forward within this project. Straight after that, we go straight in with an introduction image, and this is just to showcase what the whole project was all about. After this, we define the problem. Now, there are multiple ways that you can do this. You can either do it in a bullet point format like I have done, or you can write a short descriptive intro. Try and keep it to a maximum of 1 to 2, possibly 3 paragraphs. And what we want to do here is to highlight the problem that we're going to solve within the case study. Again here, we want to keep this very short and very snappy. Then we want to talk more about the solution. And again, we want this in either a paragraph format or a bullet point format. And the point of the solution is to highlight what we did to solve the problem. Then after we define the solution, we're just going to write down how we achieved this. Now again, I went for a very, very short paragraph at this instance, and I'm just going to highlight straight away what I did to achieve my goal. So the aim of the introduction into the case study is just to allow a recruiter to come in and just get a quick snapshot into the case study without having to go into a lot of detail, and this then will allow them to make quick decisions on whether or not they want to keep reading or move forward. This is something that we practice a lot in UX, and we give power to the user. So this is what we're doing in this instance to whether or not they can go into full detail and read everything or get an overall view case study within a quick 2-minute read. I like to add in another image at this point, and sometimes I like to show a before and after of what I started off with and what it turned out looking like. And this is just to give them a little bit of a taster of what's to come up. Start talking about my research. And it's a good idea here to introduce what you did during the research phase. Did you do competitor research? Did you do user interviews? Did you do stakeholder interviews? Anything like that we will want to put in this section. Keep it really short. 1 or 2 paragraphs is absolutely fine, and try and keep it very, very high level. We don't want to know everything that you did or every bit of detail that you did. We just want to keep this to a short narrative to say that you performed research. After that, I personally like to put down identifying and prioritising pain points. Now, in this part of the case study, I like to explain what the pain points I saw and what I was going to do going forward and putting them in priority order. So from using data from your research, again, this can be done in a short paragraph or bullet point format. But here I like to outline how I identify the problem and what I'm going to do moving forward. Then again, I like to throw in another image just to show a bit of my research or what I did. And that's just to show that I definitely did do my research. And I like to conclude my research within the research conclusion. Now again, another pattern that we are seeing is short paragraphs explaining the conclusion from the research. And the reason why I do this again is to allow recruiters to have their control and come straight to the conclusion instead of reading all of the research and just picking up the key points that they want to do to understand the overall case study without having to read the overall case study. And I swiftly move on to defining the problem. So here I like to outline my pain points in order, and then I like to give a short little paragraph defining what the problem is. Again, the reason why I do this, so people can jump around the case study and read whatever content they want to read. And again, I add in more supportive images as I'm going through the case study. So I don't like to bombard everyone with loads of text and then loads of images. I like to switch between them as I'm telling a story. Then I like to swiftly move on to the ideation stage, and this is where I start to show my designs. So this is all about the visual representation of the problem. And it outlines all the different techniques that you can do within this stage. Now, I do suggest if you have wireframes, whether you scribble them down, this is a good place to show them. If you have low fidelity wireframes, again, great place to show them. And also UI, this is a good place to start introducing these things here and just tell a story as you're going along. Then I like to throw in some technical limitations. Now, not all projects go smoothly and not all projects come without any problems. You will receive problems throughout a whole project, and they are usually technical limitations. So I just like to put in a little paragraph explaining what my technical limitations were and what my compromises were in order to deliver this project. Now, there isn't much stuff left to do on the case study, but what is really important is that you do usability testing or some form of testing with users before you launch a product. Now, I see this a lot in case studies where the testing element is left out of case studies. So if you can do testing, I highly recommend you put it in your case study because this is a core principle of UX. Usability testing gives you access to well-informed feedback. This feedback comes from actual people who are going to be using your product. The goal of usability testing is to see how users interact with the product, and then you make changes based on those results. So here I like to outline my key findings, and I do that with stats. And the reason why I use stats or numbers is because everyone can speak numbers. Whether or not you're talking to a recruiter, whether or not you're talking to a senior management team, clients, everyone understands numbers and everything is usually driven by numbers. And the final bit to my case study, I like to round it up with proving the solution. So the proving the solution is the most important part of the case study, as it clarifies what you did above actually made impact for a company or made impact for the users. So this part proves that you were able to do your job and get results. Measuring success in the form of numbers is very important because it's a language that everyone can speak. And that's it. I hope you found this video helpful and useful. There's also a link in my description that will send you to the resources section on my website where you're able to pull a template in order to write a case study much like this. And please don't forget to like and subscribe if you haven't done already. Anything that you can do on this video can really help with my engagement. So I'm really trying to grow this channel, so anything you can do to help, I would be really, really grateful. I do offer one-on-one mentoring sessions over on my Super Peer page. So if that's something you're interested in, it is also a link in the description. I do a lot of portfolio reviews, one-on-one consultations. I can help with your case studies. I can help with your CVs or anything like that. Anything you need help with, then please consider booking in a time slot. And last but not least, if you want to follow me over on Instagram, you can do so here. And until next time, bye.